to Paris. He thought, seeking a man, a desperate race with each other. Against the fox, he was defenseless. The fox would stare at him, looking deep into his eyes, bewitching him until he rose to follow it with his teeth. He would never see Craig Bradbury again. The vases would have been hidden between the rocks for a time. There would be nothing left of the pile of gold garbage. The fox turned his head. For an instant, the fire like beam in his eyes.
Don't look! Don't look in his eyes, it's your only chance!
He squeezed his eyes shut and walked out of the fox's hands. How long he waited, he didn't know. He opened his eyes after what seemed a lifetime. And he didn't know which, despite his efforts. Was he in the fox's lair, conscious for one last moment before a painful, bloody death? He blinked to clear his vision. The fox was gone. He still waited in the opening of the rock, his muscles ached. Dead on them. It was probably just another of the fox's tricks. If he were to emerge from shelter, the fox would be there waiting for him. He would remain there, lurking in trap the devilish creature and screeching. The sound of crying birds. For a moment, Trier did not know where he was. He shifted slightly, and a corner of the Gigier's frame jabbed his ruby in the fire. The sunlight streamed gloriously through. He slept for who knew how long with a fox nearby, and he had survived. Trier laughed out loud, and the sound of his laughter reminded him of his strength. We are afraid of the things we do not know, just because we do not know. We must remember the idea. Gray man could be interested in this. He wiggled out the crevice, grimacing woodley in a tight knot to not see him. Day walked beyond the next village to the city of Puyo. Although Trier was determined to go straight to some door without delay, Crane Man had counseled him to make one stop at a place called the Rock of the Falling Flowers, Puyo. It is an old, old story, Crane Man said, and Trier had settled down on his sibling after wriggling around to the most comfortable position. You know, the guy with the land has suffered many invasions, powers. China, and the Mongols have never left us in peace for once. This is the story of one such invasion. It was the Tang Chinese time, more of 500 years ago. Puyo was at the capital of the Han Kingdom, one of the three kingdoms that shared. The Tang, allied with the Shida kingdom, swept down to the north and pushed their way into the kingdom. Most of the king's army had to be called away to fight the war. There were only a handful of personal guards to defend. They received warning from the Chinese. As he and all his courtiers fled the palace, the town was stuck in the greenhouse. The king and his party were forced to retreat to the very highest point of Wu, a cliff overlooking the Kukui. There was no escape. Bravely, the king's guards placed themselves a little way down the path to bring the enemy on this side. They were overrun. All of the king's concubines and ladies in waiting crowded into London, determined to protect him from crime. The women knew well the time will not come. Well, they would be taken prisoner, probably to be tortured. They had paused and said, 3 years no longer by the time. He had risen to his knees in the excitement of the story. Is that all? He demanded. Patience. Yes. The hand army charged on him. All at once, as if all their minds had become one, the women began jumping off. Every one of them preferred them before the prisoner. You see it. The women jumping one after another, the beautiful silk dresses billowing in the air, feeling red, green, blue, and pink, like flowers. Trier gasped, his eyes round. What courage must have been. The town were victorious that day, and the women's efforts were not in vain, for they have since been the inspiration for all kinds of courage. They never even lived for a thousand years without a shiver. Trier then reached out to his crutch and broke the diamond was in the back. 3 years saw sparks flare up before him like tiny. Go climb the rock of the falling clouds and reach the earth. But remember, visit them often. You return home, tell Kramer everything you can see. The villages along Trujillo, thus far, were much like Truco. They were not seaside villages, and they were inhabited by farmers rather than potters, but they had the same feel as Truco. Small patched houses gathered in clusters along a single main road, the grand tower of a government official set apart from the rest, a temple somewhere nearby. People working hard for each other. Everyone had been kind and respectful, going about their business as soon as that means. Trujillo entered the city gates, stopped, listened. A crowd of people, oxen, and carts jostled one another in no streets. The houses were so close together that Trujillo wondered how their residents would move. Behind him, he heard shouts of impatience as people tried to pass him. He moved on, swept along by the river. On both sides of the street, shop stalls were open. Their owners shouted, mind their wares. The customers shouted, bargaining for the best prices. Never had Trujillo seen so many goods displayed, or heard so much noise. How could the people of Puyo possibly hear themselves think? There were stalls that sold food and drink, already prepared. There were stalls that sold vegetables and fish. One stall sold nothing but sweets. There were bolts of fine silk, trays of gemstones, wooden toys. All manner of household goods that he had, baskets and straws, sleeping mats, and wood. Trujillo stopped abruptly in front of one's door. It was stacked with small mountains of pottery, not as though no word, but the very dark brown stone ware known as wood, the stone food. The only seller's stall is like every size of vessel, from tiny sauce dishes to kimchi jars big enough for a man to step in. The wares were stacked in tall towers that seemed to tilt precariously. But Trujillo smiled, knowing they were steadier than he looked. He had learned well how to stack similar-sized vessels into a tower that could touch the sky and be big, never. Trujillo was just about to move on when he spotted a shelf at the back of his door. His mouth dropped open with amazement. Just three objects stood on the shelf. Three identical stone foreign walls. Italy,
boy, tell your master, the latest style those bowls are. The design is a favor of the king himself.
I dare not tell you what the king for.
Only a customer of impeccable taste can afford such an item. Is your master such a one?
He is not in the room, he could not speak. He merely bowed his head to the man and stepped away from the store, feeling a little bit.
King's design, already seen and admired, replicated the sale of the streets.
Trujillo began to walk faster, shouldering his way through the crowds. The sooner the better, the means were.